The authors have no financial interest in this presentation. As days turn into nights, Dr. Holmes bides his time at 221 Baker Street, this winter with a sense of utter boredom. He walks up his stairs every evening to his study, waiting for a case so elementary yet so mysterious. Wait, could this be it? Dr. Holmes received an email. A mystery for phaco-refractive surgeon is treatment of pre-existing astigmatism, which accounts for almost 87% of patients. Astigmatism, if left untreated, can lead to one of the most dreaded complications, that is an unhappy patient. Cataract surgeons all over the world have multiple questions on how to treat patients with pre-existing astigmatism. Intrigued after reading the email, Dr. Holmes then entered his mind palace. He started thinking of a stepladder approach, which is normally used by all cataract surgeons to manage astigmatism. The first question which was asked is, how important is topography in planning toric IOL? To answer this question, let's take a case example of a 60-year-old male with 1.4 diopter cylinder. The toric IOL was planned in this patient by using the online calculator. IOL was implanted at the plane achieved by the calculator. However, it came as a shock when post-operative cylinder was 3 diopters in spite of the IOL being aligned correctly. After checking if all the boxes were correctly ticked, we found that the answer lied in the curvature map. The patient had an irregular astigmatism of 3.2 diopters preoperatively. Thus, an accurate reading of topography with knowledge of Belin-Ambrosio display map and the EKR map helps us in planning precise toric IOL implantation. But is topography the absolute answer to all our questions? Here is a case of a 42-year-old female with a PSC cataract and a minus 2 diopter astigmatism. The topography showed with the rule astigmatism and no irregularity, but on seeing the aberrometry map, it showed higher HOA values. Post-op, the toric IOL was well centered. However, the patient was still unhappy. Residual cylindrical astigmatism of 1.2 diopters was seen post-operatively. On seeing the biomechanics of this patient, the deformation amplitude was at a higher side, that is 1.45, showing weaker biomechanical strength of the cornea. Looking at this example, we can thus infer that biomechanics also plays an important role and should be included in the pre-op workup of toric IOL planning. The next question which was asked is about the importance of posterior corneal astigmatism. In literature, it is reviewed that posterior corneal astigmatism plays a very important role in toric IOL. Till recently, the online calculators assumed a constant ratio. But with the advent of Baylor's nomogram, which took into account the posterior corneal astigmatism and final effective lens position, posterior corneal astigmatism is now included in many of the online calculators for toric IOL planning. If posterior corneal astigmatism is ignored, it can lead to overcorrection in with the rule astigmatism and undercorrection in against the rule astigmatism. The next question was about axis marking in case of toric IOL. It is a colossal waste of precise planning if toric marking is not accurate enough. Just a simple error in non-alignment of the forehead with the headrest while marking axis during toric IOL planning can lead to a change in cylinder by 1 diopter and 10 degree rotation in the axis. Thus, for appropriate toric IOL planning, a 0-180 degree reference axis is marked preoperatively in a sitting position, as supine position leads to cyclorotation in a range of 7 to 10 degrees. To deal with errors in axis marking, a number of image guiding systems are now available and provide real-time intra-op axis guides for correct IOL implantation. A dilemma which we can face is, what if the patient does not want or cannot afford a toric IOL? Thus, looking at this case example of a 58-year-old female with cataract and a cylinder of 1.36 diopter at 177 degree axis, a penetrating OCCI was planned for this patient. Postoperatively, the cylinder on A scan was 0.68 diopter at 108 degrees with a vision of 6x6. Thus, a well-performed OCCI reduces astigmatism by 0.7 diopter and can lead to better results. We have a number of corneal incision-based options like astigmatic keratotomy, femto-assisted astigmatic keratotomy, limbal relaxing incisions. We can use number of nomograms which are available online freely and plan the incisions accordingly to manage astigmatism. Thus, Dr. Holmes rightfully solved all the queries of ophthalmologists all over the world. Hence, mystery solved. He has finally deciphered the enigma of astigmatism preoperatively in cataract surgery.
Excellent video, Dr. Sirani.
Thank you.
Very nice presentation. Just few comments about your topic. One, you have discounted the lenticular astigmatism and overall astigmatism, and you are taking into consideration only the corneal astigmatism,
that's
whether
true.
It is anterior or posterior. So that is not all. I think complete astigmatism, or you know, is a global astigmatism, as you call it, like corneal, lenticular and retinal is very, very important for managing the overall astigmatism and results, you know. And second thing is, as you have said, that the head movement, head tilt, all those factors are very important in marking the astigmatism, that despite the fact you have marked the astigmatism accurately, sometimes there is residual astigmatism because of that. Not taken into consideration the with the rule or against the rule astigmatism as to how much you want to correct. So there are a couple of things, and there is one app I would suggest everyone to download. If you have a iPhone, a Toricam, or if you have a Android phone, a Crystal Toric. These are the two apps, one for the iPhone and the app, you know. And there I can, I don't know whether everyone one can see it or not, but I have a Toricam. So this is a Toricam. There's a red line which is fixed and the green line which is, and you have to first, for keeping the head straight, you can just see like wherever I want to put, so red line should cross all the 4 points so that the head is straight before you start measuring, and then you take it to the eye. You can have a 1x magnification and 3x magnification, and that 1x and 3x you can, depends on how you feel comfortable, and then you can mark with the head straight so that this 180 is 180, and then you can mark with a pen. And that's the easiest way. You don't need all that hi-fi things like
very on.
The microscope and such things, you know, those softwares which cost about 25 lakhs. So these couple of things are very important, and I think if you go ahead and incorporate
Definitely,
this thing
sir.
Also, yeah.
So the idea was basically to present it in with the cornea.
Cornea in mind. But yeah, when we're talking about the toric and astigmatism
Lenticular
marking,
also.
It has to be a complete thing.
So that is
so
the next
part
of the
video. Theory is slightly wanted, but your presentation was wonderful.
Thank you, sir. Thank
Absolutely.
You.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I think Dr. Sahni, one comment would also be of use, which would be whenever you're dealing with patients with the corneal pathology that you're already aware of. For example, a patient with a mild keratoconus who's been cross-linked, or say a patient with a corneal transplant.
Okay.
There, these simple rules don't apply.
Correct.
So if you really want to make this presentation more more broader and wider with the perspective, bring in those corneal pathologies as well.
So because of shortage of time, actually I had included lenticular astigmatism also, but because of shortage of time, because this already took up 7 minutes 30 seconds, but that was already included in the original presentation, which was 10 minutes, but I could not include that. So I had a case example of keratoconus also, but not. I
okay,
just
so you did touch upon it by
yes.
bringing in the tomography element.
Yes. So the idea was basically to encourage youngsters like me to use more and more torics. Also, a lot of people use torics, but they find surprises because they don't utilize the instruments which are already available with them.
Correct.
So that was the main idea to just like educate youngsters like me. Of how to plan a toric IOL and how to implant a toric IOL with proper precision.
Well done. I think all topographers now will have a toric planning software with it.
Yes.
And another one that is very useful, which will actually tell you the alignment based on multiple parameters, including a Chang analysis, would be the eye trace.
Yes, that's
so
true.
If you have access to that in these complicated torics, that's a very good equipment to have.
Yeah, but at the same time, if everybody has a mobile phone, so these software, these apps on the mobile phone are absolutely wonderful and accurate. I can tell you, I'm using it. The only areas where you can go wrong is when you have a totally mature white cataract where you cannot measure the astigmatism of the eye completely and only go for with the corneal astigmatism, which might be sometime erroneous, though a very small number of cases. But this is absolutely wonderful app I have used without any real serious complications, I can tell you. And that is why I have never opted for all those gadgets which cost 20-25 lakhs. Yeah. Any other questions, sir?
That was a very important point, Dr. Bharti. We should rely more on these apps than I think things like corneal hysteresis and all that, which are more expensive, push the cost to the patient. So everybody cannot afford it. So rather than over-promising, I think we should depend on these apps, which serve most of the purpose in
Very
most
good.
Of the cases.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.